attention, I would like to introduce myself. My name is David Krause, and I've kind of been in charge of organizing this event, this celebration. Well, thank you. And I would like to begin by simply welcoming all of you to what I think is going to be one of the most enjoyable barbershop experiences of my lifetime, and I hope it will be for you all too. On behalf of the Barbershop Harmony Society and the Kansas City chapter, which is the second oldest chapter in that society, and the Kansas City Convention and Visitors Bureau, and the Muehlebach Hotel, which I'm sure a lot of you who've been barbershoppers for a long time recognize this place, and it brings back a lot of memories when you come here. I want to welcome you to this event. Hope you're going to have a great time, and I'm relatively sure you will. I do want to thank real quickly, although you usually save that for later, I do want to thank real quickly one person who, without their assistance, none of this certainly would have been possible. He's one of the other people that's on this very small committee that helped organize this thing today. And he's the one who, when the hotel closed down several years ago, managed to think to come down and rescue the plaque and make sure that it did not disappear. And I think that's very significant. And he certainly helped me tremendously in getting this all put together. So I'd like for you all to recognize Mr. Gil Lefholz. Recognize the other person of this committee who put this together, and he is going to be your master of ceremonies today.
You're in trouble.
Yeah, that's right. And I'll tell you, he's the former director of the Kansas City chapter. He was a baritone, of all things, of the Mary Mugs, a very popular quartet, even with him singing in it. He was a master of ceremonies for many, many years at our international conventions, and I think about the time they invented television, he started working in it, and he was the weatherman in Kansas City on WDAF for many, many years, Mr. Dan Henry.
Begun in 1914, a date I remember quite well. But if you'll look out here on the Baltimore Street side, there are a number of photographs of the actual construction of this building. And if you look closely, you'll see some mule-drawn carts and pictures of Gil Lefholz and Frank Leone, right? Right near one of the mule-drawn carts, but it's difficult to tell which is which. But it's an early date. In fact, it seems to me we were here doing this once before. Isn't that correct? 35 years ago. Some of us are asking, why are we doing this again? And the reason being that Gil Lefholz, in his wisdom, which doesn't occur quite often, smarts to come down to this building when it was being remodeled and to see the powers that be go down into the bowels, which I described as his term, of this building, and under a lot of debris, which was another one of his terms, found the original plaque that we had hung 35 years ago and dusted it off, took it home, sent it to International. International kept it in good shape and brought it back here to Kansas City. We wish to thank Gil Lefholz superbly for doing that very nice. One of the few things he's done correctly, I might add. At this point, I would like to introduce a former a wonderful Premier Society music arranger, a former, in fact, three-time Central States District Quartet champion, a society music judge. He wrote and created the society's music category, which I might add was with Joe Stern's help. And an expert on the society's history, which is the subject he teaches every year at Harmony College. For several years he has done that, and he's here to share a bit of his vast knowledge with us. From St. Louis, may I introduce to you Mr. David Wright. Here he is.
one little thing. I think I co-authored the music category along with the gentleman over here, Ed Wasey, who's standing behind me, which you'll meet a little later. But in any case, it's a pleasure to be here, and it's a pleasure to see the enthusiasm and support for this particular occasion with representatives from our society, from the management of the Muehlebach Hotel, and from the city of Kansas City, who will be introduced a little later in this program. I'm going to take just a little bit of your time, and not a lot, because I want to help us all to understand the significance of this event and what it means to us, and not only to us, but to American music. It was well over a century ago that there emerged from many quarters of American society a music, a uniquely American style of vocal harmony. And like other uniquely American music, such as ragtime, jazz, blues, and gospel, it blended characteristic American components, freedom, improvisation, into music that has foundations coming from Europe and Africa. This music was heard everywhere. It was heard on the street corner, in the parlor, in the barbershop. It was played on the Victrola. It was performed on the vaudeville stage, on the minstrel stage, on the stage of the Chautauqua. It was practiced by rich and poor, by black and white, by men and women, by amateur and professional. It grew and developed into a rich and varied musical lore that came to be known as barbershop harmony. In the 1930s, this musical tradition began to fade with the advent of media entertainment. And though it had been a well-recognized part of the American musical scene for well over 50 years, it seemed destined to become merely a footnote in the annals of music history. That may well have been its fate, had it not been for a happenstance that occurred in this very room. It was sometime in the early part of 1938, we don't know the exact date, that two men from Tulsa chanced to meet right here in the lobby of the Muehlebach Hotel. These two gentlemen, Owen C. Cash and Rupert Hall, were acquaintances, but were not close friends. Cash was a lawyer, Hall was a businessman. Cash was returning to Tulsa from a business trip in Denver. Hall was flying to Pittsburgh. Both their flights were delayed because of bad weather. And so, here they were. Here they were, and they needed something to do. Cash, who loved the woodshed barbershop harmony, asked Hall if he could sing tenor. Rupert Hall modestly replied that, as a matter of fact, he was the best tenor in the United States. Cash suggested they go to the lounge, presumably the lounge that is right down these stairs and around to the right, to do a little harmonizing. And they did. And Cash tested him out and discovered that, as a matter of fact, Rupert Hall was a pretty good tenor. And the song he tested him out on, according to his memories from years later, was an old song that we all know now called You Tell Me Your Dream. And Mr. David Krause is going to direct us in this song. Many of us know it, and we're going to have the help of the Kansas City Chorus, and we're going to try to sing that song together.
Now, before we begin, I would like for everyone to sing along. Everyone, please join in and sing along. Let me tell you the correct lyrics, because some of us have changed them a lot over the years. You had a dream, well, I had one too. I know mine's best, because it was of you. Those are the tough ones. Here we go.
You.
lobby, where they found two more men who could sing, and they went up to Rupert Hall's room to continue their harmonizing in four parts. But while they had been down there talking, they had lamented the fact that harmonizing seemed to be a dying practice. And they resolved to organize a local singing club once they returned to Tulsa. Hall promised to call Cash once they were home to get things started. And they originally agreed to call this thing the Society for the Preservation and Propagation of Barbershop Quartet Singing in the United States, whose initials, SPPBSQSUS, were intended to surpass those of any of Franklin Roosevelt's New Deal agents. The name was soon shortened to the Society for the Preservation and Encouragement of Barbershop Quartet Singing in America, SPEBSQSA, a much needed simplification. Back in Tulsa, Cash and Hall pursued their plans. Hall arranged for a first meeting at a place called the Tulsa Club, and Cash drafted an invitation dated Wednesday, April 6, 1938, which read, "In this age of dictators and government control of everything, about the only privilege guaranteed by the Bill of Rights, not in some way supervised or directed, is the art of barbershop quartet singing. Without a doubt, we still have the right of peaceable assembly, which I am advised by a competent legal authority includes quartet singing. Writers have for a long time thought that something should be done to encourage the enjoyment of this last vestige of human liberty. Therefore, we have decided to hold a song fest on the roof garden of the Tulsa Club on Monday, April 11th at 6:30 p.m. It was signed Rupert Hall, Royal Keeper of the Minor Keys, and O.C. Cash, Permanent Third Assistant Temporary Vice Chairman. A title that Cash proudly maintained until his death. Invitations were sent out. Both men immediately began receiving the phone calls of interest. And finally, the day arrived. April 11th, 1938, it was a warm spring day in Tulsa. Cash and two others had arrived early and were standing around talking when a man named Pewty Blevins, well over 6 feet tall, came in and said, "What are we waiting for?" And so, with Blevins singing lead and Cash singing baritone, the four of those men woodshedded an old tune called Down Mobile. Down Mobile was the first song sung under the auspices of this fledgling society. And we're going to try to sing that one now, too.
Now, the good news about this one is there's almost no lyrics at all. They're very fast. Down Mobile, how I love that little gal of mine. That's it. Okay, that's all the lyrics. Here we go. And
is monumental. And after an hour or so singing and realizing that this was so much fun. Everybody was having such a good time at this meeting that the suggestion to form a permanent club was made. And someone asked, when do we meet next? Someone else jumped up and said, how about tomorrow night? From that moment was launched a series of meetings which gained national media attention, which launched meetings in other cities around the United States, and thereby triggered this movement. These events led not only to the singing society called SPEBSQSA, which today is the world's largest singing organization. 7 years later, a women's organization, the Sweet Adelines, was formed, the second largest such organization today. And over the years, a number of barbershop harmony organizations, male and female, have sprung up all over the world. The modern day movement includes over 80,000 people worldwide who sing this music. This entire movement owes its existence to the chance encounter that occurred 60 years ago, right here in the lobby of the Muehlebach Hotel. To the people of Kansas City, to the management of the Muehlebach Hotel, please know that you are the keepers of a marker that is precious and dear to the hearts of every practitioner of barbershop harmony worldwide. And moreover, I suspect that as time goes by, the significance of the event commemorated by this plaque will be understood and appreciated more by others as musicians, historians, and sociologists come to understand the role this very special music plays in American society and in our musical heritage. We admonish you to display it with pride, and we thank you very much for your hospitality and your participation in this very special occasion. Thank you.
Attended more international conventions than any living human being since Moses, I think it was. Glenn Howard had a song that he introduced to the society, and O.C. Cash and his quartet, the OP4, sang this song in contest. It was not, however, Ed Wasey's arrangement. But I imagine it was pretty good. At any rate, the chorus now under the direction of Jim Bagby will sing for you that song that was one of O.C. Cash's favorites, Bright as the Night.
Oh.
know the guy that arranged that. Especially yes. Those weird notes you have. I'm Weishi, who you will meet again. For those members of the board not to say anything, but just raise their hands, if you would, please. Give them a hand. Those are the guys that do all the work, and we really do appreciate it. We'd also like for you to meet some of the members of the international headquarters staff who are here. I remember this first fellow was a boy. In fact, he was in seventh grade when I was teaching school. His name is Dr. Greg Lyne. However, my hair's not quite as white as his. Anyway, we'd like you to meet John Schneider, the convention and events chair, director. He's right over there. Give him a hand. Finance and administration, Frank Santarelli is here. The assistant to the executive director, Dee Vesevic, is here. Where is Dee? And our international president, Ed Weishi. Microphone and accompanying Ed, and here to make a very special presentation to a very special member of the Kansas City chapter who's been sitting here patiently all along, remembers all this stuff. He remembers before this building was built. Is the executive director of SPEBS QSA, Daryl Flynn. Daryl!
Member in the Barbershop Society, and it is our great pleasure to present this to Orville today, and I'd like to ask our International President and Society President, Ed Weishi, to read this proclamation.
Bear with us for a moment, because this has got 13,000 whereas in it. And by the way, I hope you don't believe that I arranged that. Actually, I wrote what David wrote in his speech, but I... Encouragement of Barbershop Quartet Singing in America Incorporated in celebration of its 60th anniversary. Whereas, in the beginning there was Cash and Hall, and they were without form or substance. I'll accentuate the capitalized. Because the world had forsaken harmony. And whereas, Old Man Winter, being himself an aficionado of harmony, generated a snowstorm which brought together said Cash and Hall in March of 1938. And whereas said meeting of Cash and Hall took place in the lobby of the Muehlebach Hotel in Kansas City, Missouri. And whereas this fateful meeting brought forth the joyous return of harmony into the world through the founding of SPEBSQSA on the 11th of April, 1938. And whereas the year 1998 is the 60th anniversary of SPEBSQSA, and whereas of the 34,000 active members of SPEBSQSA, only one has earned the right to carry the coveted 60-year membership card. And whereas said 60-year member has long celebrated the art of harmony through his participation with the Kansas City chapter, and whereas said 60-year member has faithfully served his chapter as its president, and whereas said 60-year member has tasted the holy essence of quartetting and won two Central States District Championships, and whereas said 60-year member participated in the Kansas City chapter's first parade of quartets in 1946, and whereas said 60-year member continues to honor and uphold the code of ethics of SPBSQSA. That is true. Now, therefore, be it proclaimed that the Society for the Preservation and Encouragement of Barbershop Dance and Singing in America, Incorporated, hereby recognizes and honors with the utmost respect and admiration its only 60-year member, Orville Wilson, member number 100504, proclaimed this fourth day of April 1998 with 13,000 seals from the bottom and all that, you know, things.
Something like
that.
help us.
When you were sweet, when you were sweet,
I've been west, but I dwell in the middle, there's a light of bed.
attendance of a member of the city's Convention and Visitors Bureau Executive Committee, which we will mention again later, and Mayor Pro Tem, George Blackwood.
About three words and then leave, and welcome to Kansas City, and we're glad to have you here and looking forward to the International Convention of the year 2000, and thank you very much, and I'm out of here, but I'm not going to do that. I got to tell you guys and folks a story. I sang a bit when I was in college. I was in a small trio. I went to Baker University. You may have heard of Baker University. So we sang, and so short, I mean, after that, every year I would take a group of 6, 7, 8 guys on our stag ski trip to Colorado. Our wives were upset, but we did it anyway. You guys know about that part. One year we went, and I ended up having 4 or 5 good voices in this. We went in a kind of a band, and we practiced 2 or 3 songs that we could sing with some harmony. And I tend to think that I know how to do that some, and some of the other guys did too. So one night, we had these 3 songs down. I mean, we had them nailed. And we went to Vail, Colorado, they had little A-frame and Dillon, where you may know about. And we stopped outside. Now, I could take you, and I'm sure everybody in this room has the same experience, but it's a wonderful thing to be able to have the mic, and nobody can tell me I can't do it. It's a great country. So we went to the main entrance. Those of you who have been to Vail, the plaque tower is right here, and we're standing right there, and I said, let's do our songs. And so I was the director and the singer, and we started singing, and it was one of those nights that you die for. Great big flakes coming down, not too cold, no wind, and we started singing, I Had a Dream. That was the first song we sang. And incidentally, I'm going to ask for volunteers in a minute, because I'm going to do a quartet, but I want to sing the lead. So we started singing, and people would wander up and say, could we join? And I would stop the group. We only had 3 songs, so you really had to kind of be careful about using all of your repertoire at once. I'll never forget, by the time the last guy came up, we had about 12 or 13 people there, and we had never gotten through the 3rd song, because I kept stopping, because we couldn't sing more than 3. And a guy came over with a box. I never forget this, a box. And he said, can I join? And I said, what's in the box? And he said, this is a case of wine. And I said, we have to have auditions. But I can assure you, if you would take one of those bottles out and pass it to my friends around here, the audition might be very easy. I can do that. And I said, I'm waiting. This is more than you wanted to hear. The bottle gets about 7 people down, and it was empty. And I looked at him and I said, you have a case of wine. Turns out, I swear this is true, this guy was Robert Mondavi of the Mondavi Wine.
Oh, my goodness.
It's true. Are you calling me a liar? It's a good thing I'm his car towed. Welcome you to Kansas City. I can't wait till the year 2000, because I'm going to tell the same story at that time. And I'm going to do what I said I was going to do. Now, the words that I have were slightly different than the words you thought about singing before, because I had this idea 2 days ago. I had a dream. There, you had one too. Mine was the best because it was of you. But come, sweetheart, tell me now is the time. Okay? I want a bass, a baritone, tenor, right up here, right now.
A bass.
A bass. A bass. Get a bass up here. Get a bird. Yeah, boy, you got the bass. Are you the bass?
Right. I'm the bass.
I'm the leader. I'm the mayor pro tem.
You are.
You really tell your purple tip?
1963, when we originally hung this plaque. Would you wave your arm in the air, please? Look at that. You're looking at old people. And Bill even has the picture to prove it. We were here and enjoyed this almost as much as today. There are four of the people who were here in 1963 who have gotten together to sing the official song of Kansas City. You probably know what it is because it was written by one of our own, Joe Stern. Joe was not only famous in the city for his business in real estate, but was the Society's first international treasurer, the first editor of the Society's magazine, and helped create the judging system used to determine our champions. And now Kansas City's official song, Kansas City, My Hometown, written by Joe Stern and sung by the Kansas City Codgers.
Say a word or two.
unfortunately could not be here today, and he does send his apologies. But since he's my boss, I will tell you that since we opened the doors here at the Muehlebach last fall, this is the most fun I've had in this time. All for being here gracing the Muehlebach Hotel. I know that many of you have some very special memories of this hotel, and you have made today one of our very special memories of the new Muehlebach Hotel. So we do look forward to having you back in the year 2000 and singing in our lobbies like you did in 1989 across the street at the Marriott, or Alice Plaza then. So welcome back, and it's our pleasure to have you with us again. Thanks.
Thank you. Photogs, here's your photo op here with all these gorgeous faces up here. Well, not counting Gil. But anyway, it's wonderful. And immediately following the unveiling, Dr. Greg Line will lead everyone in the Society's theme song. And immediately after that, you're invited to step over to the original registration desk, the original reception desk, where the Kansas City Visitors and Convention Bureau is going to treat you to snacks and one drink. Coming. Photographers, take your picture. Daryl, take it away.
Shall we?
Yeah!
Pleasure for our society board to be here and do that. This is one that we shall not soon forget, and aren't we glad that we were able to share it together. The idea that started off so frivolously in the beginning has really taken off, and just now is beginning to impact the world around us. And as we approach our second 60 years, I'm reminded of a man who gave us many of our songs. His name was Al Jolson, and he often said,
"You ain't heard it."
So it is to OC and Roop and special guests like Orville tonight, or this afternoon, that we owe a deep gratitude for our beginnings. And it is to David Krause and David Wright and the Great Heart of America Chorus and the hotel that has given us a focus and an appreciation of this event today. We thank you so much. Most especially, we thank David Krause and Gil Lefholz, my bud here, who has put this together for us today. A bright conception, don't you think? And you know what? There are others, too. How many men in the room have more than 50 years' service in the Barbershop Society? Are there others? At least one. How about 40? How about 30? You betcha. These are the people that are the pioneers that have given us what it is we have today. All of you that didn't hold up your hands, hold them up right now. You have the keys to our tomorrows. And to all of us here at this wonderful event today, it just seems like a great time to rededicate ourselves to the Society's vision and to our theme of growing young together. For therein lies our next 60 years. Thank you.
Okay.